I think I got one of the best jobs because I get to talk about all the fun things in quantum mechanics that sort of get to bend your mind a little bit, and we're going to have some fun with that today. So the things that we're going to go through are going to be related to, I'm going to be very heavily grounded in optics using light, because that's what my job is. I'm an experimental quantum physicist, and I play with light. I use light to probe the quantum world. So we're going to, I'm going to give you a little bit of an introduction. I know you guys have been introduced to things like polarization of light and things like that. We're going to do a bit of review because it's going to come through very heavily in everything that we do for the rest of today. And we're going to use that to talk about entanglement. Now, you guys have also been given a little introduction about entanglement, and I heard Martin said that at some of the dinners, you guys were asking lots and lots of questions about entanglement and everything about it. So we're going to go through that some more, and we're going to talk about something called Bell's inequalities. Now, Bell's inequalities has been called one of the greatest achievements in the history of science. That might be overstating it a bit, but I think it at least belongs in that discussion. And the reason you probably, actually, how many people here have heard of Bell's inequalities before this week? Few. Okay, that's even more than I would normally expect. So you would think that, you know, the invention of penicillin, right? We all have heard about that. Or Newton and his laws of gravity and the apple falling on his head. Or all these other major scientific revolutions, Bell's inequalities really belongs in that same discussion. But the reason most of you haven't heard about it is because it's very abstract. And unfortunately, to go through it, you have to do the math. So I'm going to try and go through some examples and some analogies that are close to it to give you guys some intuitive understanding of it. But at the end of the day, it's a mathematical inequality that has a very profound statement about the world around us. So it's a lot of fun, and we're going to go through it, and we're going to talk about tests that have been done with this in the experiment and how you go about doing this in the lab and those type of things. So the first thing I want to talk about is entanglement. And entanglement is really, when you write it down mathematically, it's a very simple idea in some sense. It just means that you have a state that can't be factored. So if I write down the quantum state, here, we'll just call it psi, and so this just means I've got two qubits, and I've got two parties. I've got a person maybe over here who we'll call Alice, because that seems to be the convention in everything quantum mechanics, and I've got a second person over here called Bob. If I give them each a qubit, one of these, have you guys heard of qubits yet? All right, good. So if I give them each a qubit, well, you've got your own qubit. You can do things to it over here, and you're not going to affect anything that happens over here. You have your own copy. It's its own individual identity. And if you write the state down, it factors out. Like I've got, you know, a part that goes to Alice, a part that goes to Bob, and they're their own individual thing. And in fact, you can write down more complicated qubit states. You know, you could write down, maybe I give Alice some more complicated thing, which is just some arbitrary superposition of being something like that. And then I give Bob something that's, you know, oops, that should be a B. So again, these are just two more complicated qubits. They can do their own things to them. They have their own, in a sense, identity independent of each other. And then when you get to entanglement, well, quantum mechanics lets you do things that you can write down states that look like this, where, for example, here's a Bell state. You guys have heard of Bell states too, right? No? Okay. We will get to Bell states, and you'll see why they're called Bell states, because they're derived by a guy named John Bell for these Bell's inequalities, and we use them all the time. But I could write down a state. Nothing stops me from writing down a state that looks like this. And if you stop and you look at this, so first off, whenever I write this little sign here, the technical mathematical meaning is tensor product. You don't have to worry about it. It just means that in some sense they're separate. You can think about, you know, Alice tensor product with Bob. So it just means that they're really going to two separate things. These little subscripts here also reinforce this idea. It's a little bit redundant, but I'm just doing it for clarity, that this zero belongs to Alice, this property belongs to Bob, this belongs to Alice, this belongs to Bob. And this is a very strange type of state because you can't factor it. I can't just factor it into the part that belongs to Alice and the part that belongs to Bob up here. See, both of these belong to Alice right here, and Alice gets her state, and you know she's happy, and Bob gets his state, and he's happy. But here, even though Alice has her own physical qubit, and Bob has his own physical qubit, somehow the properties are connected between them. You can't factor it. What does this mean? Well, that's what we're going to get into with Bell's inequalities, because this is something you can't have happen in the real world. And people have thought really hard about this for a very long time. There's been a lot of debates between Einstein and Bohr and things like that that led into the arguments of John Bell. And this whole idea, this idea of entanglement and these Bell's inequalities are the reason you guys are sitting right here. It's the reason this room was built. It's the reason this institute was founded. It's the reason that this whole field of quantum information with quantum computing, cryptography, everything else started, comes about because of these inequalities and this idea of thinking about entanglement in these ways. So before we get too heavily into things, I made a slightly cheesy little video a little bit a while back, and I'd like to show it to you guys, so bear with me. And what the idea is that when you produce states like this, quantum mechanical states, then Alice and Bob will have some kind of, like the entanglement between them will allow them to exploit unique correlations that you normally wouldn't be able to see. So I'm going to show you guys a little video that deals with this. When two objects are entangled with one another, they share a peculiar connection. For example, if I were to take these two molecules and entangle them with one another, I could then take them to opposite ends of the universe, and yet they'd still be connected. Anything I did to this molecule would instantaneously affect this one. Einstein so disliked this concept, he termed it spooky action at a distance.
Nein, ich mag diese spukhafte Fernwirkung nicht. Nein, nein, nein!
Entanglement was the subject of some of the most vigorous debates between Einstein and Niels Bohr, and has played a profound role in the foundations of quantum mechanics.
But what's entanglement good for? Well, using entanglement, two people can share secret messages between them. Or you can use entanglement to build a super fast computer capable of solving problems that today's machines can't handle. In fact, you can even use entanglement to teleport the information stored in a quantum system from one place to another. Pretend for a moment that I'm an atom. Then using entanglement, I could teleport the quantum information stored within me from here to here
or here. Quantum entanglement is so strange, it's almost magical. And here to help explain quantum entanglement is special quantum magician Dan Trometer.
Thanks, Krister. Using this deck of quantum cards, Jamie and Krister will help me demonstrate the idea of quantum entanglement. First, I'll mix the cards, and then I'll have each of them mix the cards as well. But first, Jamie, please cut off about half of the cards, and then deal those into two piles, one pile for Krister, and one pile for yourself. This mixing process right now is, in a sense, a type of shuffling, mixing into two different piles. Now that you each have your own piles, you'll mix them independently. You'll deal as many cards as you like face down. Whenever you like, you can stop. Then you take everything in your hands, turn it over, lay it back down. Pick it up, and then do that again as many times as you like. Go ahead. Deal face down. Good. Fantastic. And you'll note that they're making independent decisions. Sometimes Jamie's just dealing a few, sometimes she's dealing more before she turns over. Same with Krister. Also note, Jamie stopped already. Krister continues to shuffle. Independent decisions. In fact, you could take these two different decks of cards, take them across the universe, and yet, because they're entangled, something very mysterious will happen. You would think that because of those independent choices and shuffling procedures, that they would have random orders. When in fact, if we look at the top card of Krister's pile, it's a black six. The top card of Jamie's pile is also a black six. Maybe a coincidence. Let's try it. Top card of Krister's is a red jack. Red jack. Red ten. Red ten. Fives. Nines. Eights. Threes. Eights. Threes. Aces. And queens. Because they're quantumly entangled, they have a mysterious correlation. And that is quantum entanglement.
That's the idea. That's the essence of quantum entanglement, is that you can have correlations that are surprising and stronger than what you would normally expect with anything classical. Now, by the end of this talk, I'm sure a good chunk of you will have figured out how that trick was done. And that's fine. Don't tell anybody else, because let them try and figure it out and stew on it. But it illustrates the idea that there's something really strange going on. And a lot of what we try to do in quantum information is use entanglement to try and come up with new types of games or scenarios that you can use these correlations to do surprising things, like quantum computing, for example. So we're going to take a slight break from entanglement just for a moment, because I need to just verify and go through a few things with you regarding polarization of light, because we're going to use polarization of light to study entanglement and concepts around that. Now, I should first just ask, can anybody tell me what light is? Photon. What's a photon? This is now circular. Light is just energy. It comes from the sun, it comes from the light bulbs around us, and light has this kind of dual nature that it seems to act like a wave and both a particle. It's got this dual nature to it. And a photon is just the smallest unit of light that you can possibly have. It's a particle of light. So light has a number of interesting properties. First of all, it travels through space at a huge, huge speed. Does anybody know the speed of light? Big. So it turns out that is the speed limit of the universe. You can't have anything go faster than the speed of light. Now, that statement needs a little asterisk and qualifier. It turns out there are some things that you can, in nature, that you can actually have go faster than the speed of light, but the real thing is you can't send information faster than the speed of light. So there are certain circumstances you can set up in the lab where you can have, even within light itself, you can have parts of the light go faster than C. But the idea is the real restriction, the thing that you're often not told, is the real restriction comes from you can't send information faster than the speed of light. And that's just a message. It could be anything that you think of. Any way you could think about communicating, you know, the outcome of something, you can't do that. And that's a very general principle that we will run into later on in these talks. So that's the absolute speed limit. Also, we'll need to know a fact a little bit later on. What happens to light as it enters water or glass or something like that? So exactly, you can think of, for the purposes of this lecture, you can think of how light interacts with matter as the following. Sorry, I'm going to be switching different board markers to different colors. And there's nothing special about it. It's just whatever marker I happen to grab at that particular moment. So we're going to use the most simplistic kind of model of an atom and electron for right now. Here's the nucleus. Here's an electron. And in physics, have you guys ever dealt with springs before? Put up your hand if you've dealt with springs in physics yet. OK. So you'll learn about springs It's just usually represented like this. You put, you know, a mass on a spring, and then it starts to go back and forth. You will learn this by the time 11th or 12th grade physics comes around. And then you'll do the experiment. You say, I know everything there is to know about springs. And then you realize that most of physics is just springs. If we don't know how to model something in the world, we just treat it as a spring and a whole series of springs. So this is one of the first models of an atom and electron. How does an atom and electron behave? Well, we're going to attach it with a spring. And then we're going to see what happens. So maybe if we come in and we drive light, so light comes in and interacts with this, it's going to excite this electron and it'll start oscillating back and forth. It turns out this is a pretty darn good model for how an atom works. It's not perfect. To do that, you have to go to, this is called what we call the Lorentz model. And if you want to do better than this, you have to go to full quantum mechanics. This is what one of Bohr's big ideas was, that, you know, here the electron just can't be anywhere. It has to be in discrete energy levels and things like that. But just for the purpose of this is actually a pretty good model. And you can think about light coming in, exciting this electron, and causing it to oscillate up and down. And what happens with atoms, the reason light slows down is because as light comes in, it excites these electrons, and it causes them to oscillate up and down, and then it re-emits the light. And then that light gets absorbed by the next atom in the material. It oscillates up and down, and then it re-emits it again. And this goes on, and because of this whole readmission and absorption process takes some time, that's what slows down light within the actual material. And the amount it slows down is related to the property of the index of refraction and things like that. So the direction in which light comes in is you can imagine you have an atom. It can start causing it to oscillate in, you know, one direction or another or a different direction. That's related to the polarization of light. So light travels through space, and, you know, it can oscillate like this. It's got this wave-like type property. It behaves very, very much like just a wave in the ocean. But, you know, of course, it can also go like this. It's not constrained by gravity or things like that. It can you know, go in any kind of direction. It can even be circular. It can travel this way or this way as it rotates through space. So this is the property of light known as its polarization. And we're going to be using the polarization of light quite extensively throughout this lecture and the subsequent lectures, because this is one of the tricks that we have. It's one of the best handles we have on controlling light. So we're going to use this extensively in almost all of the experiments for dealing with quantum mechanics. So you're absolutely right. Electric field is just the direction of the oscillation of the electric field as it travels through space. And it also turns out for a single photon, it's equivalent to what we call the spin of a photon. But we don't need to go into too much about that right now. So you can treat polarization as a vector. Have you guys seen polarization as a vector yet? Put up your hand if you've seen polarization as a vector. Okay, we're going to go through this, and we'll go through it again. How many people here have seen, like, trigonometry before, like cosines, sines, things like that? Okay. So you can think about a convenient way to represent the way that light behaves is as a vector. And we can draw, pretend that this is there, fixed. And so if light is oscillating this direction, so the electric field as it's going through space, you know, it's coming at you and it's going like this, we're going to call that horizontal polarization. Just so you know, I'm going to actually draw this as a 90 degree angle. And if light is coming at you and it's oscillating like this, we're going to call it vertically polarized. And these two things form what we call an orthonormal basis. So if light's coming here or it's coming here, those are two orthogonal things to one another. Now, you can also put in light, you can start writing this down. If this is your basis, H and V, you can start writing other states of light as a combination of them. So for example, if I had a polarization vector here that was equal to a superposition of H plus V, then this thing would be oscillating this way, and it would have half of its component. You can think about it as being partially being H polarized and partially being V polarized. And what's happening is if this thing is oscillating like this towards you, you can think about it simultaneously as the components. If you were to put a projector here, it's like a flashlight, and look at the shadow here and a flashlight looking at the shadow here, the two components are going to be going like this. So, sorry, it's kind of like doing this. I'm not very coordinated at that. But it's sort of like this guy's going to go up and this guy's going to come out. And then if you think about what's happening is these two components, they're going to form a vector that's going to be oscillating in that direction there. Does that kind of make sense, or is that? Okay. So you can play other things. Let's say, for example, I made a different state of light where I made the state can you guys see this with this there? I'll put this up. Actually, I'm going to need this in just a sec, so I won't put that up yet. So this would be equal to minus H plus V. Bigger? Sure. The whole thing? Yeah. Can you see the H here? All right. Yes. Apparently, I need to write bigger. Okay. Is that better? It's visible? Okay. So you can see it from space. All right. So this is V. And this guy right here, we're going to say this type of polarization right here is a combination of H plus V. This guy right here, if the vector is oriented this way, it's going to be minus H plus V. Okay? And what happens with this vector is, well, instead of oscillating this direction, it's going to come at you going foompa, 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 foompa at this other angle. And if you think about the vector components, what's happening is instead of going like this, it's going like that. That's what the minus sign does there. Okay? Now what happens if I create the state H plus IV? Have you guys seen this before? This is circular polarization. And what's going to happen is it's going to cause this vector, this I that shows up, this imaginary number, all it means is that you're delaying the wave a little bit from the like the components. And that's going to cause this vector to rotate. And I'll show you how this works. If you think about these vectors, I'm going to call this guy plus right now. That's just a plus. This guy right here, since you can't see it, I'm going to write it up here. This is going to be minus. And this guy right here, it's going to be, we'll call it circular. Okay? And if you think about what you have to do to get this guy oscillating, well, I've got the component of H and V. So this is for plus. Then this is the, that actually looks like an H. Plus. So this would be the H component of it. And then the V component here is oscillating in what we call phase with it. So you can think about it also following, the same kind of path. So these are the two components that are going wumpa, 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 wumpa. And then if you put those two together, it'll cause it to oscillate in this kind of diagonal direction. So this is going to be the plus state, which is this guy right here. Okay? So if we do minus H plus V, well, what we've done is we're going to shift these two things so that they're now out of sync a bit. So now I'm going to shift the H, and what's going to happen is it's going to have a minimum here. So wherever the other guy has a minimum, this guy's going to have, sorry, that should actually be, so now, if you notice, for the minus state, H has been, the whole kind of cosine has just been shifted over. It's out of phase now. So wherever I had a maximum before, this state is now, it's now going to be a minimum on the H component. And the V, well, it's going to stay the same. We haven't touched it because it's simply plus V, so it's going to stay the same. And then, sorry, I sincerely apologize about my lack of ability to draw cosines, but these two things together will cause you to oscillate like that. So the minus just means shift out of phase by half a wavelength. So I'm just going to shift the wavelength of the H relative to the V. And this is a really good exercise. If you guys go home, you want to think about something tonight, think about how these work and see if you can make these vectors trace out these various paths. So the final thing we're going to do is the circular one. So the circular one, what this says is keep H the same. So we're going to keep the same H's here. And this means shift V by a quarter of a wavelength. That's physically what we're going to do. And this gets a little bit confusing because what's going to happen now is that instead of having a maximum here, I'm actually going to be coming down a bit, and then this whole wave is going to be shifted relative to this one by a quarter of a wavelength. And what this means is that they're now kind of a little bit out of sync. So in this case, instead of going like this, what's going to be happening is you're going to be coming kind of down, and then they're going to cross the two components, and they'll come back up, and they'll go like that. And if you start to trace that out, it's a little bit confusing. So try this at home. Like, you actually go home and start thinking about what happens. It really does mean that you're going to be 90 degrees out of phase. So instead of starting at the origin with this one and going, you know, boom, boom, which will give you this, because you think of this moving, the projection here and the projection here are just going to be giving you something that's going to oscillate up and down or backwards and forwards. With this guy, what it really means is if I start here and I start here, so this is my starting point, so V is 0 and H is out here, then my vector is going to be lined up here. And then at some other future time, what's going to happen is they're going to move like that, which will then put my vector here. And it'll have rotated to there. And then as this guy comes down to here, it's going to hit 0 just as this guy comes up to here. And it's going to cause us to rotate there. And then this guy is going to come down, and this guy is going to move. And it's going to cause it to rotate. And then you can see, if you keep doing this out of phase, you get a circle. That's how circular polarization works. So it turns out you can think about, so you might think it's funny to put an imaginary number in there. It turns out you can, this just means that whenever you see an imaginary number, this isn't a Cartesian plane that you normally are used to. So normally you're thinking of like a vector system that's x and y, right? This thing can actually be complex, where one of your axes can be complex. I can't get into fully like the full mathematical rigor behind it. You will encounter that soon enough when you get to college. If I did it, it would take probably about another 45 minutes to go through where that comes from. But that's why I'm saying if you see something that looks like this, an imaginary sign, all it means is that the components of the vectors, it just changes how they oscillate relative to one another. So this is an attempt to kind of explain it. It looks a bit messy, but the point is if you see something like this, it just means that the polarization is doing this as it's coming towards you, as opposed to just oscillating nicely. And this is just the mathematical representation. Fortunately, we don't really need this for too much. And we'll be sticking mostly to linear polarization. So how many people was this like perfectly clear to? Okay, that's better than I expected. All right, so that's good. So there's just something I stole from Wikipedia, which is actually a very good source of stuff. Here's like a representation of circular polarization just as it rotates through. And you guys have also been, I've told, introduced to the concept of what a polarizer is. So I'd like to go through just quickly a polarizer. It's really just a very simple device. It can look like this. This is just a sheet of material. And what it does is if you put it, this light bulb right here, it's emitting what we call unpolarized light. It's just spewing out photons with every type of polarization you can imagine that you can put together. And what this polarizer does is it comes up and it filters out and it only lets the component of the polarization through that's aligned with this material. And so you can cut out the light quite a bit. If you take two of these guys together, then what you can do is, oh look, you can't see me, haha, I'm here, right? Because the light is polarized. Right now it's coming from the light bulb, it has no polarization. Now suddenly it's maybe all oscillating vertically. And if I put this other one 90 degrees to that, it'll block out both of those components. So if you rotate these things, you can let varying amounts of light in. We'll go through the math for it in a second. But I've also stole a few, borrowed permanently, a few 3D glasses from the movie theaters. The way these 3D glasses work, the first version of these, what would happen is you would have two different projectors in this movie cinema, and it would project light that was horizontally polarized and light that was vertically polarized. And then one of the goggles on the right or the left, one would let in horizontal and one would let vertical in, so you would see your eye would see two different images from these two different projectors. It's great, except it didn't work that well because light is linear. Well, what happens if you turn your head 45 degrees? Suddenly, the polarizer is now aligned in between, and it's letting both light from both projectors in simultaneously, and you completely lose the 3D effect. So I've actually been to cinemas a few years ago when the 3D craze first began, and they used these type of projectors, and it was really irritating because anytime you like changed your head even slightly, you lost the effect completely. Now what they use is they use circular polarization, so they either have light from one projector going this way or from the other projector going in the opposite direction. And then what happens is it doesn't matter how you turn your head, it'll always still appear to be circular as long as you turn your head this way. If you start rotating your head like that, you'll lose the effect, but that's really hard and you'll probably damage something. So this is how circular polarizers work. So what I want to do is just go through slightly, like really quickly, the math of what a polarizer does, what these things do. You can already see it blocks components of light. So let's pretend for a moment now that I have H and V. And what we're going to do is I've got now my plus state coming in. And this is just equal, again, to 1 over root 2 H plus V. So it's a superposition of having 50% H, 50% V. And now I take a polarizer, and I just align it with the H-axis, for example. Well, how much of this light is going to get through? 50% of it, because half the light will be oscillating in the H direction, half the component's going to be in the vertical direction. Now, what if I had some other state here of light, and it could be any arbitrary angle, theta, up here, and we'll just call it some psi. So how much light is going to get through here? Yeah, so it turns out if you look at what this thing does, the probability that this is in the quantum mechanical thing, the probability of this polarizer that you're going to get light through, well, it's aligned along the h-axis. This guy is aligned some psi, and you have to look at the overlap. Have you guys seen anything that looks like this yet with vectors? This is, in a sense, the length, the probability of what you get through. Well, what's the projection of this onto this? It's it's trigonometry. You can draw, it'll help if I draw a triangle. So what's the component of this vector that lies along here? It's just cosine theta. And that's squared. So the amount of light that gets through a polarizer as you rotate it is just going to be the cosine squared of the angle of the light. So if you know, my light's oriented this way, then it'll be cosine theta of that. So this has its own name. It's called Malice's law. He got a law out of this. So that's I guess to get something this simple, you have to be alive in the 1800s. So this is Malice's law, and you can think of you can also think of this being the other way around. So maybe instead of having my light, you know, looking at if my polarizer's fixed and my light's here, what happens is if instead I rotate my polarizer by some angle theta, well, these are really, you can think about them as being the same thing. So even if I rotate my polarizer by the theta, you're going to get this cos squared theta term out. What happens if instead my polarizer was aligned along the vertical direction? What's going to be the component that's oscillating in the vertical direction? So it'll actually be sine theta, because this is the cos theta. This is the projection. This is just trigonometry of this triangle. Sine theta gives you the component that's going to be oscillating in the vertical direction. So it's going to be sine squared theta.
I was thinking theta relative.
Right. Yeah, sorry. I meant to keep the same theta there. And this is good news, because if you add cos squared and sine squared, what do you get? 1, which means that if you had a polarizer that let either you had two outputs, instead of just absorbing the light like this, but imagine that this polarizer behaved a little bit differently. It did let all the light through, that was H, and reflected everything that was V. Well, those two things have to add to 1 because you're not losing any light, and so that makes a polarizer. So this is just how a polarizer behaves, and this is Malice's law. We, in our lab, we can use, it turns out you can use lots of materials. There's some in nature that are naturally what we call birefringent. You can use calcite. It's just it's a crystal, and it has the structure that it will naturally split light up into different polarization components. In the lab, we use a something called a beam splitter cube, and it literally looks like this. It's a cube with something along the diagonal, and what happens is if you send light in, some H plus V. The H component comes out here, and the V component gets reflected like that. So this way you can split light up into its constituent components, recombine them, do lots of things. You could use these to build an interferometer, or you could just have an interferometer that isn't sensitive to polarization. It just sends half the light here, half the light there, doesn't care about the polarization. So it's something very similar to, in fact, you can build a polarization interferometer out of this. OK, so somebody asked me how you can make a circular polarizer, because this only splits your light into these two components. Well, what you could do is change your basis here. What that means is, right now, if I have circular polarization, it just means that the components are a quarter of a wavelength outside of each other. What you can do is use a piece of material, a special device called a wave plate. And what it does is it introduces a quarter wavelength delay into your material. So you can undo, or you could either create a quarter wavelength delay or undo it, depending on what you do. And now what that does is it turns your light from the circular basis, from rotating in a circle, to rotating in a plane. And so you can use devices called wave plates to either introduce half a wavelength or a quarter wavelength delay. And then you can start changing light in between all of these different states. So that's another device you can use. Those glasses, the three glasses that we had, they have a quarter wave plate in front of them, followed by just a regular polarizer. So we're going to move on. This is the basics of polarization. And now you have all the tools that we need to talk about Bell's inequalities and entanglement in particular. So what I'd like to do is, start asking you some questions about reality. Thank you. Step on that. So, are you guys real? Yeah, do you exist? Or are you just figments of my imagination? We could all be figments of someone else's imagination or my own. Maybe it's just a dream. Sorry? You probably are a figment of, I probably am a figment of your imagination. So there's this idea, it goes back, it's been debated amongst philosophers for thousands and thousands of years, is the world real or is it just in some sense our imagination? Does this ball exist independent of me looking at it? It depends. It depends on your viewpoint on the world. There's a strong school of philosophy that you can roughly divide into, believing that things are really there, that things, this ball is there independent of me. That if I look at the moon, you know, the moon doesn't disappear if I'm not looking at it, right? It's only there if I look at it. It's kind of a strange thing to be interacting with the world if things aren't really here. And there's another school of thought in philosophy that can be roughly boiled down into, the most extreme version of it would be something called solipsism. And this is the idea that nothing exists, it's all in our head, and in fact, you know, the world is completely, it's not there anytime you don't look. Pretty extreme viewpoints of reality. And it turns out quantum mechanics has something to say about this, and this is Bell's inequalities. For the first time in the history of philosophy and science, we have something that is experimentally testable that we can use to make statements about whether things are real in the world or not, and put limits on them. We can't answer the question, are you really here or not, but we can do a little bit better than what we've done before, because before what would happen is you'd have two philosophers and they would just butt heads saying, you know, you're really there, and then they're saying, well, you're not there at all, so I win the argument. So now we actually have something that we can go in nature and in some sense test for this. And that's what the power of Bell's inequalities are. And we're going to use these entanglement correlations to probe them. So this has very deep consequences, so to speak. You know, for example, you can forget like whether you exist or not. Like this ball, for example, it has a property of being yellow. Now, this property of yellowness is in some sense innate to the ball. But you might wonder what would happen if, for example, you know, you close your eyes, does this ball cease to being yellow, or is it only because you observe it that it takes on this property? This is a really strange way to think about the world, but quantum mechanics really does, in some sense, behave like that. And that's one of the strange things of quantum theory. This is what people, it really disturbed you, because for the longest time, a lot of physicists in the 1800s, 1900s, even in relativity, things have definite properties that exist outside of whether we need to look at it. This, in some sense, forms a deterministic universe. If you knew where every atom was, using classical mechanics, if you knew where every atom was, its position and its velocity, how it's behaving, you would know everything that happened in history, and you would know everything in the future, because everything is just, it's almost like a big clock. That's what the theory tells us, that things are just going before. We have no such thing as free will. Because, after all, if you knew the whole state of the universe, you would know exactly everything in the past and the future. And that's how people thought. And then suddenly, you have quantum mechanics come along and say, well, things are actually just all probabilities. And how does this behave? Like, do we have free will? Well, it turns out that that question hasn't been answered yet. We don't know. And there's compatible theories or interpretations of quantum mechanics that deal with both. But Bell's inequalities is the closest we can come to start really dissecting and answering some of these questions. So very deep stuff. This is why I like it. This is why I think it's one of the most important discoveries in physics. And it reminds me, does anybody read any web comics here? Like XKCD or things like that? Okay. Has anybody seen the Saturday morning breakfast cereal? Anybody heard of that? Sometimes? Okay. I much prefer XKCD, but there was a really funny Saturday morning breakfast cereal here the other day, and it really kind of sums up this idea of maybe of solipsism. So here's a baby, And he says, oh God, I'm the only thing in reality. They're all dead. Not even dead. They never were because time is gone too. Some time passes. I'm the only mind in all of reality. Ha 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 ha. No, no. Don't give in. Stay sane. Madness is the unmaking of the self. Woo! No, no. And then the baby goes, keep it together, keep it to peekaboo. Ha 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 ha. So this is the idea, like you close your eyes and it's like, oh no, the reality like disappeared if I stopped existing. And then you open your eyes and it's like an observation, aha, everything's back, right? So this kind of, I think, nicely sums up these two viewpoints of like what's really happening. And maybe babies really do think this way. So Bell's inequalities, it's very abstract. In the end, we have to do the math to go through and understand it, and we will go through the math. But it's going to be, in the end, you might be like, wait, what? What does that mean? What Bell's inequality is, it's not about quantum mechanics at all. It's about a world with realism, where things really do, in some sense, exist with reality. So if you assume that objects have definite properties outside if you close your eyes, that property might change, then Bell's inequalities is really about that world. And it reminds me a lot of the following. In fact, we can come up with a close analog based on this picture right here. This is a picture by Escher. And I love his work because there's often lots of mathematical complexity hidden within these, and they're fun to look at. They appease the inner physicist and mathematician in me. So you'll quickly see that there's something very wrong with the staircase, because if you look, this guy right here, he's walking up the stairs, 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 he's walking up the stairs. It's called ascending and descending, or vice versa, they're going down the staircase in all directions. Physically impossible, you can't build something like this in the real world, or can you? This is a Lego set that somebody made out of ascending, descending, and it's the same kind of thing. Now, this is actually an optical illusion. They had to take it from a particular vantage point, and if you see it sort of ruins the magic. But you would be very surprised if you found out the world really behaved this way, that you could continually go up a set of staircases like this. So let's just try and write down, because we're physicists, let's try and quantify this and see what's really happening here. I'm going to try my best to redraw this figure, the Escher one, and we'll see how successful I am. So basically what we've got here in Escher's drawing, something that kind of looks like this. Actually, not really, but anyway, you'll get the point. Okay, so anyways, and there's stairs. Okay, well, let's write down some math for what this is saying. So I'm going to label these different points, different things. I'm going to call this A. Let's call this A here. B, A prime. So just label these four different points. And I'm going to come up with an operator which is called the height operator. And all it does is it looks at, say, for example, the difference between B minus A. And if B minus A is greater than or equal to 0, then you get plus 1. So we'll call this, it has a value of plus 1. But if it's less than 0, then we're going to call it minus 1. So this just means that B is higher than A, and that staircase is ascending, so we'll give it a plus 1. Does that make sense? Is that clear to everybody? Just a simple thing, like which is higher. So let's write down an inequality for this. And what we can see is that... So let's do, so I'm just going to write down something. I'm going to call it S, just an equation. So let's look at the value of B minus A plus plus the value of h of a prime minus b plus the value of h of b prime minus a prime plus the value of h of b prime minus a. So this is my equation S, and it just compares, you know, is this higher than this? Is this higher than this? Is this higher than this? And is this higher than this? So these guys can each take a value of either plus or minus 1. So in our physical world, what's the maximum this can be? Okay, I was slightly less rigorous. What I'm going to do is say that if they're equal, this is going to be 0. Sorry, that was a slight screw up on my part. Yeah, sorry, I screwed that up. So we'll keep this up. So in the physical world, what's the maximum this can take? 2, right? Because you can't have all of these be positive. It just means the staircase keeps going up and up and up. What's the minimum it can be? -2. It just means that your staircase goes down, down, and then it goes up at the end. So you have 3 minus 1. What's the value in Escher's world? It's 4. Or -4. So the value of S, so this quantity S, its value has to be less than or equal to 2 in I'll call this real life, not the television show. So it has to be less than 2. But in Escher's world, that's an E for Escher, well, this quantity can be larger than that. So it would be very strange if suddenly one day you walked in and you found that staircases were going in crazy directions. And this is exactly what we're going to try and do with Bell's inequalities. We're going to try and construct the same type of staircase analogy, but with real-life objects and their properties, and then see if quantum mechanics can violate this. Just as a side note, I screwed up. I got these two numbers switched around before. I've corrected it now. So this will now work out the correct way. Now what we're going to do is go in and talk about realism. Now, I can't do the full proof here because it involves some calculus and it'll take like too long, but we can go through pretty much get the essence of this proof. So Bell's inequalities say that, well, what would happen if things really did have these properties of being real? So in quantum mechanics, you have, has anybody heard of the Heisenberg uncertainty principle? Put up your hand. Okay. Heisenberg uncertainty principle just says that you can't know where something is and how fast it's going simultaneously. Because you can either know one or the other, but you can't know both. And this got people like Einstein really disturbed. They started saying, well, no, maybe this is just a limitation of quantum mechanics. Maybe this thing, it really does have something. We'll call it a hidden variable. Some hidden variable, a little toggle switch inside that says, aha, I know how fast I'm going, and aha, I know what my position is. It's just that with quantum mechanics and the way we interact with it, we can't see what that hidden variable is. It's outside of our measurement scope. So we can either measure the position well or the velocity well, but this really did have some kind of definite position and definite particle and momentum that it knew about. So hidden variables. And it seems to be that quantum mechanics is in conflict with this idea because really something has an uncertain momentum and an uncertain velocity until you measure it. You don't know what it's going to be. And once you measure its position, you have no information about how fast it was going and vice versa. So quantum mechanics seems to be in contradiction with this idea that maybe there's something hidden there that's really specifying what's going on, and maybe a better theory down the road will come in with these little hidden variables and say, no, this is what's really happening. So this is the background for this debate. And Einstein wrote a paper with two other co-authors. It's called the EPR paper. And he put together a thought experiment where he showed that what would happen if you had these kind of little hidden variables. And it's a much more complicated argument. Bohr argued back and forth, and it wasn't really resolved. I mean, it was resolved, but not very satisfactorily. And that got a guy named John Bell interested in this problem. He said, wait a minute, I actually like Einstein's arguments. I think that reality is something that's here, that Einstein was onto the right thing, that quantum mechanics isn't the full description of things, that we really do have these little hidden variables in there. And he set out to look at what would happen in this case. And he came up with a very general theory. In fact, he came up with a situation that covers every possible hidden variable theory you can think of. So anything you can dream up of, you think you've come up with something new, it's actually encased, ensconed in this class of theories. And so he imagined the following situation. Okay, imagine I've got some person here. We'll call them Charlie, right? So for C. And they're able to produce particles, cheeseburgers, whatever we want, anything you can think of. And they're going to send a copy here to our good friend Bob. And they're going to send another copy of their cheeseburgers or whatever else here to Alice. In our case, they'll probably end up being photons, as you'll see, but we go to the quantum case. But we think it's very general. And so now these guys have two options. They can choose to measure the properties of these things using different bases or different measurement settings. So this thing here is just a big measurement device. And you know, there's two knobs. So here we're going to call it B and B prime. And Charlie's got his set to say, for example, B prime. So he can choose to do one type of measurement on it. And same thing here. Alice over here, she has her measurement device, and she can do two measurements on them. They don't even have to be the same measurements. They can be completely different measurements. If you were thinking of sending polarization, this could correspond to, you know, putting your polarizer aligned this way or this way, and then Bob could choose two different polarization settings. If they're cheeseburgers, they could choose to either maybe taste the cheeseburger or to smell it, right? And so there's different ideas. You can think about stuff in any way you want. The idea is that there's two different measurements that you can do here, two different measurements they can do here, and you can look at the results of them. Maybe the cheeseburgers have ketchup on them, right? Maybe they don't. Charlie's the cook, and he's preparing these cheeseburgers. Yeah, you need to taste it or you can smell it. You can't do both, right? Or you know, you can't set your polarizer this way and then measure it away because you've affected it. If you send light through a polarizer, it gets through. It's now in a different polarization state. So now what we can do is this measurement device. Each of them, they're going to have two outcomes. They can either be plus one or they can be minus one. So I'll explain what I mean by that. So for example, if it was a polarizer that this thing was, and you set the polarizer up at, say, this angle, position A, if light gets through and it's horizontal, then you might say, oh, we're just going to label that a 1. If it gets reflected and comes out the other port of our beam splitter, then you know, you say if it gets here, it's H, so light comes in. If it comes out here, it's a minus 1 and it's a V. So you could do something like that. You could say, for example, maybe if I taste it and I find out that there was ketchup on it, I give it a plus 1. If there was no ketchup, I'd give it a minus 1. If I smell it, that's the other measurement, I get a plus 1. If I taste it, I get a minus 1. So what we've got here is a situation that's a little bit similar to that Escher model before, where you know, we created this type of thing where you're going up the stairs and we created an inequality with that. We could do the exact same thing. So things can have properties of being plus 1 or minus 1, plus 1 or minus 1. And we also make the assumption that these two devices are completely independent of one another. So whatever influence that Alice is making, Charlie isn't going to be influenced by that in any way at all. Okay? Okay, so what we do is Charlie sits here and starts sending out lots of particles, cheeseburgers, whatever, cars, whatever you want to make measurements on, starts sending out these particles, and then Alice and Bob, randomly, independent of one another, they choose to either measure A or A prime, taste, smell, I guess that was the other one, or you know, different polarization components, whatever you want, and they record the results. And at the end of this, they get together and they're going to make some comparisons. Now what we're going to do is they record the various values of their experiment, and they get together and they say, okay, well, we're going to make a comparison. And this is Bell's famous statement. Now, I've got these funny brackets here. All this means is that we do the experiment many times and we take the average value, right? So if you flipped a coin and I said that, you know, if I got heads, I get plus one, tails, I get minus one. If I flip the coin on 1,000 times, what on average will the value be? Zero. So this is the same type of thing. So we're going to look at all the cases that Alice chose to measure A, setting A, so she set her system to be in that configuration. And then also when Bob also chose to, you know, at the same time, random and completely independent, chose to measure his system in measurement B, we're going to take and look at what the average value is. Because, you know, A, it could either come out as a plus one or a minus one. This one can come out as a plus one or a minus one as well. Yeah, sorry, I just am not really looking at my notes very well. So we're going to do the same thing. We're going to look at what is the average value whenever Alice and Bob both chose to look at setting A. What's the average value? And then what's the average value if Alice chose setting A prime and Bob chose setting B, and so on. This negative sign, as you can guess, will come out to be very important later on. All right, so what's the maximum value this thing could possibly be, this inequality here? So let's take a look at what this means, because we're assuming reality. So I'm just going to give you guys one example, and then you guys can go away and think about it. But let's say, for example, just for the fun of it, that we live in a really strange world, that Charlie here, who has this hidden variable that he's setting, you know, whatever our state is, he's always arranged it so that no matter what happens, that Alice, whenever she measures A, she's going to get plus one. Whenever she measures A prime, she gets plus one. And Bob, nope, oh, sorry, yeah, plus. B gets plus one, and B prime also gets plus one. Just for fun, right? Maybe this just happened in the world, like where you flip your coins every time they come up heads. Okay? So if that's the case, well, what's the product of these two? It's just going to be one. What's the product of these two? One. In fact, all of these are going to be one. So what's the max value that this can take on? Two. Okay? So in that case, this is equal to two. Now, you can see if I had changed this to all be minus ones, then the maximum value, the minimum value that this would be minus two. Okay? So we know that this can go minus two. I want you guys to work out with each other. See if you can come up with a way where, you know, find out some combination of assignments. See if you can get anything higher or lower than that. I should make this very clear. If you choose to measure setting A, you're going to get one of two outcomes. You're going to get either plus one or minus one. It's just you put it in measurement apparatus. Then what you do is you decide to measure A prime. He gets rid of that measurement apparatus, takes a second measurement apparatus, puts it in, which can also give him, you know, plus or minus one. It just might be doing a completely different measurement. So each measurement is limited to being, no matter what setting he does, you know, he could get, so A could be equal to plus or minus one. This could be equal to plus or minus one. This could be equal to plus or minus one. But of course, you start to see that once you set B, then it's hard to get any other kind of value. So I want you just to take a few minutes and think about, see if you can convince yourselves that this can only go between 2 and minus 2. We're going to start the quantum version of this. So this is what happens with classical mechanics. Let's just go through the analysis. And instead of using quantum cheeseburgers, we're going to use photons and a Bell state. And we'll see if we come up with a similar type of expression. Okay? So hopefully you've convinced yourselves, at least to some amount, that this can't be larger than 2. At these, you know, whatever Charlie's sending out, he creates an object and has a definite property to it, say color, polarization, something like that, then this thing has to hold true. Okay, let's just go through and see what happens quantum mechanically. And we're going to use entangled states of polarization. So right now what's going to happen is Instead, we're going to do the quantum version of this, and we're going to have our source over here of photons, and they're going to be producing a special entangled state called the Bell state. This is a phi plus. I'll write that down in a minute. And then what's going to happen here is we're again going to send it to Alice and Bob, and they're going to use a polarizer. So that's just a polarizing beam splitter, which we saw before, which can split the polarization components up. And Bob can also, just for the fun of it, he can rotate the basis of the polarization. So, you know, he can either choose to set the polarizer this axis, he can choose to change it to some different angle, whatever he wants. So I'll say this is Bob. And we're going to come back over here. And we're going to split this up again. And of course, you know, the component of H and V get through. So if we get an outcome over here, we'll call it minus 1, plus 1 here, minus 1 here, plus 1 out here. This is phi plus. I'll rewrite this in a second. And we're going to use this entangled state. It's one of the Bell states. And the entangled state form is phi plus is equal to 1 over root 2 H plus V V. Okay? And what we're really going to do, so this is what we produce here. And just for clarity, because we're gonna break this up in a second, what I can redo is rewrite this whole thing as, because I'm going to send one half of it to Alice, and then I'm going to send one half of it to Bob. And same thing here. And from now on, there's going to be parts where I'm just going to drop this tensor product thing just because it's a little bit cumbersome to write. So what I really mean is that Alice and Bob have their own state. I could have written it like this too, but just to make it clearer and easier, we'll do it this way. So now we get these two. So now Alice gets her particle over here. Label that. And Bob gets his particle. And we're going to see what kind of shenanigans they can come up to. This next part is a bunch of math. This is the heavy-duty kind of math component to it. And we will probably won't get time to finish the whole thing, but tomorrow afternoon we'll finish it up. And I'll at least get you started on this. And then if anybody's enterprising and wants to continue it tonight and see if they can work on it, that would be fantastic too. Okay, so the first thing that we're going to do is Alice and Bob, they get to choose what they want. They're going to make two different measurement settings. This corresponds to physically taking their polarizer, their polarizing beam splitter, and you know, Alice can say, you know what, I'm going to measure this way and this way. And Bob says, forget that, I'm going to measure like this and like that. So they can choose to either put their polarizer in at this angle and measure the H and V components, or they can choose to measure whatever angle they want. So Alice is going to take two measurement angles because she can rotate her polarizer. And you know, she can either rotate it to an angle A or maybe to another angle A prime. And Bob can rotate his to B or maybe some different angle B prime. And it's just independent. They'll make independent decisions from one another. OK, so let's take just as an example to simplify some of the math. So you can think about, I'll just draw a simpler picture up here, too, that will aid us somewhat. If you look at Alice's side of things, so here's what happens in Alice, right? What you can find out is that here's my polarization basis that we drew before. And now what we're going to do is we're going to set the polarizer to be at some angle. And so we set this angle right here. Alice is going to maybe set it to some arbitrary alpha. And this could either be, what we'll find is this will be either A or A prime, some angle that she chooses to set it to. But right now we'll just set it as alpha, just to keep things general. And what we'll find is that This polarizer has a new set of bases, which we'll call V prime and H prime. And this just means that it's, am I too small again? So this is a gigantic V. This is giant H. This is the new H prime. And that's our V prime. So we can rewrite these two. We can just do a simple what we call basis transformation. What that means is we represent these H primes in terms of these H's and convert between the two in a way that'll make things a little bit easier. So what we're going to do is I can write down for any arbitrary alpha that, H, what's this thing going to be projected onto H? Well, this state right here, this H prime, that has a projection coming down here. And that projection is just going to be the cosine of this vector here. So H is going to be equal to, what I want to do is I want to change this state, H and V, into the basis of the polarizer, because we're going to be doing measurements with the polarizer. So what I really want to do is kind of take my basis and figure out what is the representation of H in terms of V. And that's going to be, this component here is going to be a, this is going to be equal to, sine alpha H prime minus sine alpha V prime. This is the transformation I need to take H into this basis. This is, in a sense, the projection onto here, because I can take a cos alpha up to project here, and then a sine alpha is also what I need to project. I'm going to redraw this in a simpler way. So imagine right now we've got our head sort of like this, right? And we're going to now rotate our head like that. Okay, so everybody tilt your head like that. And if I redraw it, what I really want to do is just come up with an easier representation where now this is just H prime. And then what I'll see is it's a V prime H prime. This is the initial basis, was now something that looks like V, and this guy is H. And then this angle between them is some angle alpha. So this vector, in terms of this new basis, right, it's going to have a cosine component along here, and it's going to have a minus sine alpha that's going to be pointing down this direction, because it's pointing that way. So that's where I get this expression from. Okay, and I can rewrite V in the exact same way, except this time, V, it's in terms of the same alpha right here. What you're going to find is that it's going to be sine alpha H prime plus cosine alpha V prime. So this is the transformation that you need for a rotation. It turns out this is a very general type of transformation that you can use for any kind of vector when you're doing a rotation to a different basis. Does that make sense to everybody so far? It's just algebra. We're just rewriting things into an easier way. Okay, so you can also do the exact same thing for Bob. And Bob, he's going to be doing the exact same thing. He'll be choosing a different setup in his case. Here we've got H prime, V prime, this is the basis of the polarizer, and then this is his V and his H. And he's going to be off by some angle beta for Bob. His is perfectly identical, which means that we can use the exact same relations for Bob. So you know, if it's Alice, it'll be alpha. Bob, it'll be beta. Alice, Bob. Alice, Bob. Sorry, I probably just messed up all your notes, but I can do that. So just, you know, if it's Alice we're talking about, these equations just have alpha in them. If they're Bob, it's just beta. It's the same kind of transformation. I'll tell you what, I'll go through a few more lines of this. We won't get quite to the end. But we'll finish up tomorrow, but I'd like to go through maybe a few more lines of this proof. The next bits are actually just algebra. We're just going to crank through a bunch of algebra, OK? And you guys can do, if you want, you can go home and practice this tonight and see if you can get to the thrilling conclusion before the lecture tomorrow. OK, so are you guys happy with this notion? We'll come back and write it if we need to. You've got this. I'm going to erase this because I'm going to need all the space I can get. OK, so let's just do, we know we have these two relationships here. And we know we have this equation here. And since our polarization measurements are going to be made in terms of these alphas and betas, let's see what happens to these polarizers given these different angles. So let's just substitute these guys into here. OK? So I'm going to plug, this is my equation 1. And here is 2. And here is 3. And remember, these guys both apply to Alice and Bob. OK, so let's rewrite our quantum state. Plus, and let's rewrite it in terms of these guys. So it's going to be a 1 over root 2. And immediately you can see this is going to turn into a gigantic mass. Because now what we've got here is for Bob, he's going to have cosine alpha h prime minus sine alpha v prime times, and I need a bigger bracket here, times cosine beta h prime minus sine beta v prime. OK, that just was all to replace this, right? So now we can rewrite that first term in there. And then, of course, I can come back down, and I can do the second term, which is the VVs. And it's the exact same thing. You're going to end up with sine alpha h prime plus cosine alpha okay, and this is the old VV term. So this is, again, Alice, Bob. OK, so what have we done here? We've just succeeded in making this appear to be much more complicated. OK, well, how many people here know how to multiply through whatever these things are called, algebra? All right, can everybody do, you know, a plus b times c plus d? All right, so in the interest of time and lunch, I'm going to skip ahead a few lines. You guys can verify the arithmetic if you want at night. And if you do this, and we gather all the like terms, we're going to end up with something that looks like this. This is going to come down a few lines of algebra, and we will end up with 1 over root 2 times cosine A cosine B plus sine A plus sine. Oops, these are alphas. Right. I used a slightly different convention in my notes, which was a silly thing to do. so these are just betas. And this is in terms of A h prime, awesome, Bob. So that's one half of the thing that you end up with, and the other half is a very similar beta, cos, alpha, and you end up with a, again, h prime, plus v prime, a, b, bracket, big bracket. Okay, so that took up, I'm trying to write big and now I've crashed into things. So you end up with something that looks like this. This has a nice simplification. You can use the trig identities. There's ways that you can simplify this. And it turns out that this thing right here, very nicely, turns into cosine of alpha minus beta. And this guy becomes sine alpha minus beta. I screwed something up in the line. I think that makes it correct. Oh, yeah, so sorry, I forgot to mention, there's a whole bunch of HV prime terms, right? This is why I said, can anybody do the factory, like the expansion? It turns out those all cancel. So all those cross terms, bam, because they're orthogonal. Boom, all right, so they're gone. See, I wouldn't want to be you. And so what you end up with is this expression here, where you have this HH, I'll just write this out, cosine alpha minus beta, then h prime, in the interest of time, I will just drop the a's and b's, you guys know where they go, plus sine alpha minus beta times h prime minus V prime. Okay. And then all in terms of 1 over root 2. So this is the end of this whole kind of rigmarole. You end up with this fairly nice expression at the end. You can further simplify this if you like. So I'll leave you on a cliffhanger. What's the maximum value it can be? So we were dealing with something called Bell's inequalities. And what Bell's inequalities is about is trying to find it's about making a statement about what we can say about the nature of reality. So if you think that items have properties independent of their measurement, so that this ball is blue independent, or sorry, blue, it's yellow independent of what I observe it as being, then you can make statements about properties. So let's just go back and I will refresh you what our ultimate aim is. We're going to construct a theory that, or a situation that is completely general. It applies to any situation that you can think of where we have something called a hidden variable. So you guys have encountered lots of things this week. For example, you've seen things that look like this. People have written down a state that might look like and again, if I write too small, please just interrupt me, because I will write too small, and I just need to be reminded. So maybe I give you this state right here, and I prepare a copy of it. And it's in a superposition of being either horizontally or vertically polarized. And I send it through a polarizer, and boom, it comes out being horizontally polarized. Okay. Now I redo the experiment. I, in the exact same way, prepare a photon that's identical in this state, send it through a polarizer, and this time it comes out to be V. And the question is this process really random? Did this state, this photon, know that it was going to be H or V depending on the polarizer? Was there some hidden little switch in there, a little hidden variable that tells it that, you know what, this time if you encounter a polarizer, you're going to come out H, or this time it's going to be V, and quantum mechanics just doesn't know about it? Or is it really in a superposition, and there is no kind of hidden variable? This photon doesn't know whether it's going to be H or V until it hits the polarizer, then suddenly it decides to be H. So is there something truly random going on where this doesn't have a defined property of either being H or V until we actually see it? Or is quantum mechanics just an approximation to something that's deeper, where these things, this always knew it was going to be H, or it was always going to be V, but the best thing that we can do is use quantum mechanics to describe it as being H plus V. So do these hidden variables exist? Or is quantum mechanics really all there is? Or is there something beyond quantum mechanics that quantum mechanics, you know, maybe someday there will be a better theory that will let us get access to these little variables, and then we'll know the whole truth. And, you know, things like superposition, this is just quantum mechanics' way of dealing with the fact that we can't get access to these hidden variables. So this was a big argument that lasted a very long time. And yesterday we derived an inequality known as Bell's inequality that makes a statement about these hidden variables. And it's a very general one. It encompasses everything to do with hidden variables. Any kind of hidden variable theory you can come up with that assigns definite properties to things. So maybe, you know, I'm producing these photons, and there's this little switch that's going, this time you're going to be an H, this time you're going to be a V, but quantum mechanics treats it like that. You can come up with a very general type of description for that. And the setting was the following. You have some source of particles, photons, cheeseburgers, whatever it is. You can make it anything. It's very arbitrary. And you send it to two parties, who we'll conveniently call Alice and Bob. So one day, most of you guys are going to go on to be great scientists and physicists. I'm confident that many of you will achieve great things. And some of you may even have the distinct pleasure of inventing something new. Be very careful, because whatever convention you use, you will force on generations of people who follow your footsteps. So someone decided that we're going to have two people, A and B, Alice and Bob. And now everything that we do in quantum information seems to always rely on Alice and Bob. And then if you have to add a third party, then it's always Charlie who is C. So Alice, Bob, and Charlie, and then Eve, the eavesdropper. We're stuck with that. So Alice and Bob, they get their states. They get, in this case, it could be photons. And you can define, they can do measurements. So Bob can say, you know what? I'm going to have two different measuring apparatuses. So here's my measurement, I'll call it A. Or I have a second measurement apparatus called A prime. And at my own choosing, I can choose to either swap in A or A prime and do different measurements. And then this can have two outcomes, plus or minus one, plus one, or minus one. So I can swap between the two. And then Alice can do the exact, you know what? I've already got this backwards. This should be B for Bob. All right. And the same thing over here. Alice has two measurements. And these can either be plus one or minus one, plus one or minus one. OK? So Bell went ahead and he said, OK, so let's just say, you know, maybe the source here produces a thousand different particles and sends them out. And the source can be doing whatever they want. And then Alice and Bob make their independent measurements on them. At the end, what's the average value of their collective measurements? So what we're going to do is write down a little inequality, which is A times B. So the result of what the average measurement of A is times B. If anybody... going to be like that, plus AB prime minus A prime B prime. So this is just a fairly arbitrary thing. The people asked yesterday why this minus sign is here. It's here because. It's because we can. There's not really a deeper reason for it than that. Other than that, it's a valid thing to write down. And so we're just going to write down the statement. And it's going to be a statement about reality. And if you think about all the different possible outcomes that you can do, all the possible combinations, so you average over all of these things, this bracket just means, you know, average the product of these two. So, you know, sometimes, you know, A is going to be one, sometimes B is going to be one, sometimes you get minus one, sometimes you get minus one here. What's the, on average, the value you're going to get? Like if you flip a coin 1,000 times, you're going to get 50, you know, 500 times, roughly you'd expect to get heads, 500 times you'd expect to get tails. That's all we mean here. And we find that for anything where you start assigning these things definite properties, this has to be less than or equal to 2. And it's somewhat analogous, not perfectly analogous, to that thing that we did with Escher, where we had the different staircases, and then you find that that inequality that you can derive there, it can't be larger than 2 either. So let's just take this exact same setup right here, and we're going to now try it with a quantum state. And what we're going to do is, for our source, so we're going to do an experiment with quantum mechanics, because after all, this should be valid for quantum mechanics. If quantum mechanics follows this type of thing, the inequality should come out to 2. And instead of our source, we're going to, it's a really irritating thing right there. We're going to send in one of these Bell states. You guys have now probably heard so much about Bell states and entangled states that you're sick of them. Don't be sick of them. They're really cool. And this is going to be one of the cool things that will come out of it. We're going to send one half of our Bell state, one part of it, again, to Bob. And now this time, Bob, his two measurements are, he's going to have a, I'll try to draw this in 3D, and probably not do so well. He's going to have a polarizer that's just going to take the photons, and if the light goes through the polarizer, it's going to come out in the basis H prime. And if it gets reflected, it's going to come out in some basis V prime. And we're just going to call this equal, if we get this result, we'll call that plus 1. This one will be minus 1. And so Bob can choose to do two different settings with his polarizer. He can either take it and he can rotate it one way and then choose to make measurements, see if he gets it H prime or V prime, or he can rotate it to a different angle. And so the angle, he has some angle that he can rotate it by, and we'll call these angles, just for completeness, angle B or B prime. So those are the two settings he can use. It's just, I choose to measure in this basis, or I choose to measure it this way. And of course, Alice can do the exact same thing. And so, you know, I'm not going to draw this one in 3D, but she has two different measurement settings here. She can either have this rotated at angle A or angle A prime. And again, we're going to get two outcomes. This will be Alice's H, and that'll be plus 1. This again will be plus 1, minus 1, minus 1. And you can see how this behaves. All right. So let's go through and do this calculation, calculate what this value is. Our plan of attack is we're going to calculate for using this entangled state and Alice and Bob switching their measurements to two different measurement settings. After all, those are just two different analyzers that fits within this model. What's the value of S? What's the biggest value of S that we can get? And just to skip ahead, the answer is the value is going to be larger than 2. Oh my goodness, what does that mean? And we'll go through what actually that implies for stuff. So what can we do? Well, since we're going to be measuring in these two different bases, and Alice and Bob can each rotate by some angle, their polarizers, what we did yesterday was we said, okay, well, just forget these angles, but for just some arbitrary angle beta and some arbitrary angle alpha, we're going to try and calculate what the average values of say, like a quantity like this is going to be for these two arbitrary angles, and then we can just start putting in these different angles for the different combinations. So we're going to solve this problem generally first. And the easiest way to do that is to take this state that I should write down what 5 plus is. This is 1 over root 2 of this is Alice's, this is Bob's, this is Alice's, and this is Bob's. Okay, and so this is the state that they're sent out in. They're in some basis H and V. But our polarizer is going to be off at some different angle, say alpha or beta. It's just an alpha. And so what we want to do is rewrite this state in terms of what the polarizer basis is. Oops, that should be. V. H, And we're going to want to write this in terms of H primes, and then also V primes. So just what's the translation? There's a mathematical relationship we derived yesterday for that. And when we do that, we're just trying to rewrite this in a different basis. You can stick this in. Each of these guys right here, as you guys are probably becoming quite used to, you can multiply these all through. So this is not all that different than, say, taking, you know, A plus B times C plus D, right? And you can multiply that expression out. Here, the A is actually just this whole thing, this whole quantum state. You can treat it the exact same way. And that's all we're doing here. And you go through, and what you end up with is, if you simplify this all out, you end up with these four terms. I made a slight mistake yesterday. I wrote HH minus VV. It's actually HV minus VH, like that. And you end up with this relationship. You can derive that by yourself. And so from this, we can start asking ourselves some questions. For an arbitrary angle, so if you know, Bob chooses some angle alpha and to rotate his polarizer to make polarization measurements, and Bob chooses some other angle, then what are the states, like what's the outcome going to be for here? So the first thing is, quite conveniently, the reason I did this is because now we can look at what all the possible outcomes are going to be, and we can read them directly off. So if Alice, I'll put these back in. So if Alice detects a horizontally polarized photon, we're going to call that a plus one on her setting. So that'll be like a plus one. If Bob detects horizontal, we've just assigned that to be our plus one. So these are kind of like, you know, Bob has chosen to make some measurement angle beta, and then if he gets H, it's a plus one. If he gets a V, it's minus one. That's what I tried to write here, is that if he gets H, it's equal to plus one, V is equal to minus one. Okay? So then they both would get a result plus one. Here they would both get a result minus one, and then you get plus one minus one, or minus one plus one. Okay, I'm going to go through and finish up another step of this proof, and then we're going to discuss it a little bit more and go back and review it. Okay, you know, maybe my light's coming along and it's polarized horizontally, right? And if I have a polarizer that's also aligned with the light, all of it gets through. If it's down at some angle, none of it gets through. It's a zero. Now, yeah, exactly. So the probability of what the light gets through. So now if I put it at 45 degrees, then half of it gets through, half of it would be absorbed, or we'd be vertically polarized. So the idea is that because Alice and Bob are getting photons coming to them, and they're going to be polarized in different configurations, you know, Alice is either going to get a horizontal or a vertical photon, and Bob's either going to get a horizontal or a vertically polarized photon, but in this weird superposition. If Alice and Bob always put their polarizers the exact same way, right, they're always going to get the same results, because these photons are correlated in the same direction. So if Bob chooses to measure, you know, say, have his polarizer aligned, so it's vertical, and he gets a V over here, he knows that Alice had a vertically polarized photon. And so then if Alice were to do the same thing, they would find that they're correlated in this way. So we want to say that what happens if Alice and Bob now have the freedom to choose different polarizer settings. So maybe Alice measures this way, and Bob chooses to measure that way. Or Alice chooses to measure over here, and Bob chooses to measure in some other configuration. So now what we're doing is deriving the most general sort of form of this. So if Alice chooses some arbitrary angle, so here's my photon, some arbitrary angle alpha, and Bob chooses some other arbitrary angle beta to put his polarizer, what's the probability that they'll both come out, they'll both see, you know, a click as H, or they'll both see HV, both see V, one sees H, one sees V, one sees V, one sees H. What are all the possible combinations? And that's what we're trying to do with this section right here. So the idea here is to make this easier, to figure out to do this calculation, what we're going to do is, say we assume that our state is in, it's coming in here, the photon, and then the polarizer is angled like that. We're trying to find the representation. So what component of the photon lies in this direction, and which we're calling H prime, and which component of it lies orthogonal to that? And that's we derived a relationship yesterday for that, and then that related the two, like H to H prime and V to V prime, and had cosines and sines in it. And that's what we plugged in here to the state. And then we've just gone through, and this is just cranking through the algebra of expanding things until you get to this point. So we get to this point, and now we can say, what's the probability that, what's the expectation value? What's the average value of of some alpha times some beta? Okay, so what's the? This is what we're ultimately trying to calculate, but to get this, we're going to have to calculate some probabilities. So, before we can calculate this, I need to know the probability that I'm going to get H prime, H prime. So what's the probability I'm going to get this term right here? Well, that's just going to be equal to the magnitude of the overlap of H prime of Alice, Bob, with my state phi plus, where phi plus is just equal to that squared. And it turns out, now we've got this in a very nice form that it becomes very easy to see what's going to happen. This part here, this measurement, will only select components that are align this direction. Turns out there's only one component here where that's true, where it's HH, and it comes out here, it's got a probability of, it's got an amplitude of 1 over root 2 cos alpha minus beta. So I can just read off the answer right here. And the only component that will contribute to this happening is going to be equal to 1 over root 2 cosine alpha minus beta squared, which is just equal to 1 half cosine squared alpha minus beta. Okay? So that's how you calculate the probability of this guy. That's the reason we went through all this algebraic gymnastics, was to put it in a form where it's in terms of these bases, so then you can calculate the four different combinations, what's the probability. In fact, you can also see that the probability of getting a VV is going to be exactly the same, because it has the same prefactor here that this guy had. So it's going to have the exact same thing. It's going to be 1 half cosine squared alpha minus beta. Anybody want to hazard a guess at what the probability of getting, of Alice getting an H and Bob getting a V is going to be? Yeah, sine. And then it also turns out that this is also the same probability that you're going to get a V prime, that Alice gets V prime and Bob gets H prime.
Can you please explain again where you got the 1 over root 2 cosine alpha minus beta?
Yep, I can, basically how I did this step, right? Yeah, okay. So you could take out, what you want to do is find out what component of this state, you want to find out what's the probability that I'm going to get two H's, that Alice gets an H photon and Bob gets an H photon. So to do this, you have to do this, you take your original state, this whole thing, and you take the the inner product of H and H prime. So you write your vector this way, and this allows you to calculate the amplitude. So now what I do is I take H and H prime for Alice and Bob, and I would multiply this whole thing through. I'll do it out here. What you would end up with is 1 over root 2 times cosine of alpha minus beta, right? And then I'm going to end up with an H prime where this is Alice times an H prime for Bob. Does that make sense so far? All I've done is I've taken these two H primes and I'm multiplying them through. One's going to apply to Alice, one's going to apply to Bob's horizontal photon. These two things are they're vectors, they're perfectly overlapping. So that becomes a 1, that becomes a 1. And so that remains through. Now, if I do the same thing with the next component, right, I'm going to have H prime with the overlap of V prime times the H prime overlap with V prime. These two things are orthogonal to one another. These vectors are at opposite angles. So this goes to 0. So we can get rid of that term. And you can start to see by following the exact same thing, right? Well, here I'm going to have an H prime overlap with an H prime. That'll give me 1. But here I'm going to have H prime overlap with V prime. That's going to give me 0. So 1 times 0 is 0. So that cancels. And then that whole thing will cancel. And it just leaves me, in the end, with two 0 terms. And then I'm going to be left with the only thing that's going to be left over is cosine alpha minus beta for the overlap of those two. And then the probability is the square of those two. Does that make sense? OK, if I skip too many steps, just like put the brakes on. OK, so we now have a, so we now know what the probability is going to be for getting all the various possibilities between Alice and Bob. And what I'd like to do is say, OK, so for some arbitrary alpha and beta setting, what's the average value going to be? Well, you can see that there's going to be some times that with some probability I'm going to get 1, or I might get like minus 1s. And what's going to be the average value I would expect? So, well, if I take and I get two H's, right? So what we call here the probability of H prime, right? That's the number of times I'm going to get two H's. And that value here is just going to be 1 times 1, because we've considered H as a 1 and for Bob and Alice. And then I also get a second term here, which is the probability they both get Vs. And again, that's going to be minus 1 times minus 1. So really, that just becomes a 1. And I also have the case where I have P, where Alice gets an H, Bob gets a V prime, and that just becomes 1 times minus 1 plus our final term, which is V prime H prime of minus 1 times 1. So this is what the average value is going to be for any kind of combination that you would expect. So we can substitute in our values here, and what we're going to find is we're going to get these two things are both 1, so this is just going to become 1 half cos squared alpha plus 1 half cos squared alpha. So this just becomes cos squared alpha minus beta. And then I've got two minuses, and so this is going to become minus sine squared alpha minus beta. OK, so that's what you'd expect the average value to be for any kind of combination of alphas and betas. All right. Now, our inequality doesn't ask for this. Our inequality asks for this, for two different measurement settings. So it's not just enough to have alpha and beta. We also have to have the two different configurations. So what we're going to do is, but now we know what it is for any arbitrary alpha and beta, so we can just stick in the various values and calculate things directly using this expression. What we're going to do is, you can go through and use some calculus to figure out what kind of angles will give you the biggest value of this S. I'm just going to cheat and tell you guys what the angles are. And then if you want to go through and take the derivatives of this expression in order to try and maximize it, then you can do so. But if, for example, Alice and Bob choose the following angle settings, so we're going to say that for Alice, She's going to choose the settings. What did I put her down for? And Bob's going to choose the angles pi by 4 and 0. So they have completely different measurement settings. They're going to choose these settings. They're all different. If you notice, they're all different by pi by 4. And these two guys are different by pi by 4. And this guy is different by pi by 8. And this guy are different by pi by 8, too. Vectorially, you can represent these measurement settings as being here we've got b prime at 0. And then we come up to by pi by 8. And you get this is a prime. And then this angle right here is going to be pi by 4, and it's b. And then this angle right here is going to be a, and it's going to be 3 pi by 8. So these are the settings, these are the angles that they choose to choose their polarizer. Alice is going to either choose to rotate hers by 3 pi by 8 or by pi by 4. So she's going to take my polarizer and say, I can either put it this way or I can put it this way. You know, each measurement setting, she does it completely random and independent. Bob, he can choose to either go 0 or pi by 4. Okay? So what happens if we now plug in to this expression? So the expression, again, remember, is equal to, actually, let's just calculate what this is going to be. So if I plug in AB into this expression, so these values, A and B, into here, then what I have to do is this term right here becomes a 3 pi by 8. This term here becomes 3 pi by 8. If you do the math, you can calculate that this is equal to root 2 over 2. That's what the average value will be for that particular angle. And we can do this again with a prime b. And that's going to also be equal to root 2 over 2. And then we can do also a b prime. Oh, look, that also comes out to be root 2 over 2. Not so surprising, because all the angles, all the combinations are separated by pi by 4. And then the final one here is a prime b prime. And that's going to become equal to root 2 over 2 minus root 2 over 2. OK? So now we know these three values right here. And so we take these values. We look at our expression, this Bell inequality. We plug them all in. And what do we end up with? Exactly. So now we're going to get 2 root 2 over 2 plus root 2 over 2 plus root 2 over 2 minus a minus root 2 over 2, which is equal to 2 root 2. Ta-da! So it turns out we've done these measurements in the lab. You can prepare these entangled states. And we get a violation. We can see these values. I think the first experiment that really clearly demonstrate this measured a value using the setup of 2.697 plus or minus 0.015, which is, you know, much bigger than 2. It's a much greater violation than what you'd expect. And a little side note, I think this experiment was done by Alain Aspect in France. Him and John Bell, it's rumored that they were up for a Nobel Prize for this experiment. It was that profound. John Bell died before the committee could make their decision, and you can't give the Nobel Prize to someone who's dead. So there's rumors that he was, they were pretty close to getting it, but unfortunately they didn't. It turns out we made some very important assumptions when we went through this discussion. For example, one of them is somebody already mentioned it, the idea of locality, that things can't travel faster than the speed of light. What we've assumed is that Bob and Alice have independent control of their measurements, that their apparatuses don't affect each other in any way. But what if that's not true? What if, over here, there's like some small little gremlin who lives inside of Bob's setup, and another gremlin that lives in Alice's setup, and a third gremlin that lives inside the source. And so the source is producing, so what happens is Bob goes to make his measurement setting, he chooses a setting, and then the little gremlin says, hee 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 hee, Bob has chosen the setting, and Alice makes her setting, and the gremlin goes, ha 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 ha, and it communicates and says, okay, you know what, their polarizers are set this way, now you're gonna produce this state. Then it turns out you can violate this inequality because you've got a hidden variable that's not just defining a source, but it also includes the measurement apparatus. Maybe nature behaves this way, and that there's elements of reality, you have to also include the measurement setup as well. So how can you get around this? Well, there is a way. What you can do is take these experiment, and you can take Alice and Bob and separate them by great distances. Maybe you put Alice on the moon, Bob stays on Earth, and there's a spaceship in between that's sending out entangled photons. So it sends out a pair of photons, and then while the photons are in flight, then Alice decides to make her decision of what measurement to make. And now if you believe in general or special relativity, well, the speed of light is constant. You can't send messages faster than the speed of light. So there's no way for these gremlins to communicate back and forth what the message is because Alice will get her, by the time Alice, the photon's on its way, Alice says at the last minute, aha, I'm gonna choose this measurement. There's no way that the gremlin can then communicate that back to the source and cheat. So this is something called locality. The first measurements that were done were just done in a lab, and we couldn't verify that there wasn't a hidden variable in somewhere inside the various measurement apparatuses. It took until the late 90s for this measurement to actually take place, where we took things really far apart, so they're space-like separated, that's what we call it. And while the photons were being launched in that period of time, we decided what measurement we're gonna make and also set our polarizers. And we're able to make this measurement. And so you can close this, it's called a loophole to Bell's inequalities. And so the idea is that you can't have a local hidden variable theory, a hidden variable theory that respects the speed of light. However, you can have hidden variable theories that maybe say, forget about locality. So maybe things can travel faster than the speed of light. If you accept that, then you can construct a hidden variable theory that works, because after all, your gremlins can communicate faster than the speed of light, and they can send the messages back to the source. But someone did come up with a theory that, strangely enough, it's called the Bohmian interpretation of quantum mechanics. It reproduces all the results of quantum mechanics. It's a hidden variable theory, and it doesn't obey locality. Things happen faster than the speed of light all the time in this interpretation of quantum mechanics, but the weird thing is, and kind of frustratingly so, this faster than light business that happens within it, it always occurs in just the right way that you could never use it to send a message. So you can never, even though there's low locality happening all the time, the information can never actually, you couldn't use it to send a message. So there are valid non-local hidden variable theories out there that could possibly explain reality if you want to keep it. But it's a very strange thing. I was talking at lunch. When I first started university, I was told, you know, you can choose two of the following three things. You can have marks, you can have friends, you can have sleep. I chose marks and friends, and now I'm older and I'm paying for it. So quantum mechanics, it seems to force us into, you know, if you want to have your ideas of the world, as a physicist, I strongly believe in the idea of locality. Like, you know, it's relativity. Einstein told us that nothing, you can't send messages faster than the speed of light, that's somehow the rule. And I also really like the idea that when I close my eyes, the moon doesn't disappear, that things have an independent reality outside of any kind of measurements I make on them, that they somehow are there. So you have these two things. You have locality and reality. Quantum mechanics says, go ahead and pick one, but you can't have both. And that's a very strange type of thing to think about. There's a whole bunch of other like minor loopholes several loopholes that exist in Bell's inequalities. That's the biggest one. They've all been closed independently, but we haven't been able to create an experiment yet that closes everything simultaneously. So there is still the possibility that nature behaves in a very malicious and strange way. But there's active work going on for that. And I think that will be potentially in the next 5 to 10 years, something that's everything's closed at the same time, and that'll be a huge achievement in physics for experimentalists. And these inequalities, this idea of thinking about stuff in terms of information, it really goes down to the very foundations of quantum mechanics, and it's the basis of everything. I said yesterday that from Bell's inequalities, we got quantum information. This was really the genesis. This is the beginning of everything. Very briefly, I'm going to tell you about, you're going to see in the lab today how things are created, like how we generate photons. We've heard a lot about these entangled states. There's a number of different ways you can produce them using atoms, using molecules, and using photons. I am very biased. I spend my entire day working with photons, so I'm going to tell you how we do that. And the idea is as follows. If you're playing a musical instrument, as you pluck a chord, right, the string starts vibrating. And you get a pure note that comes out of it, except the sound isn't pure. You sometimes get overtones. Whenever you pluck an instrument, your voice, everything else, it vibrates, and sometimes you can not only be vibrating at one frequency, but also at twice the frequency as well. Light, we can do the exact same thing. We can take a special crystal, so just a piece of material. You would think it was glass, but it's actually a special type of material. And what happens is we send in light of one color, and by exciting it, we can get out light of a different color. And it's like producing overtones in the same way. It's called a nonlinear process. You'll see lots of it in the lab today. It turns out there's a special quantum mechanical version that you need the rules of quantum mechanics, where we're going to do something, it's called spontaneous parametric down conversion. In fact, we'll just call it down conversion for short. And the idea is you take this special crystal, and I send in light of one color. So in this case, I'm going to send in blue light. Blue light, it's very energetic photons. It's photons that have a lot of energy in them. It's also the ones that will give you skin cancer. So that's why you wear sunscreen. That's what you're trying to block out. And this will come in. And remember yesterday we talked about how light propagates through a medium. It goes in. It causes the atoms to vibrate up and down. And depending on the polarization of this light, you can cause atoms to oscillate or vibrate in different directions, then the light's re-emitted, and then it's absorbed again, it's re-emitted, it's absorbed. It's a lot like playing a musical instrument, where you're plucking a string, and you're putting energy into the string, it vibrates, and then it produces sound. Here what you're doing is you're coming in with this blue pump, being this very intense beam of light, and then you're causing the atoms to vibrate up and down, and then they produce a note back out, which is just more light, a different color, or the same color. But sometimes if you pluck the string hard enough, if you drive the atoms hard enough, what you can do is cause a blue photon that comes in to spontaneously fission into a pair of red photons. So this one photon will come in, be absorbed by the atom. The atom starts, you know, vibrating back and forth like very, very strongly, and then it'll produce two red photons. And then I'll write down, this will have some frequency here for this photon, and then maybe omega 1, omega 2. So energy has to be conserved by this process. The energy of a photon is given by E equals h bar omega, which also just means that the frequencies have to sum up in order for energy to be conserved. You can't lose energy through this process. So this process guarantees that your two photons come out. And also within the crystal, momentum is conserved too. So you notice here, these two photons are coming off in different directions, but they're exactly opposite of one another, so their momentums in this direction cancel. So you're not picking up any momentum there. And so their momentums, in this case, we represent momentum as being K, not P. It's a convention for photons in optics. Or another way you can visualize this is that somehow a pump photon comes in, excites the atom into some excited state, and then you get two photons that decay out. And then the momentum has to be conserved. So this is, you know, K1, my first photon, K2. And these vectors have to add up to the original pump. So using this, we can generate pairs of photons. This is a quantum process. There isn't a classical analog. You need quantum mechanics for this. And so we're making the the crystal, the atoms sing in this kind of quantum way, and out comes these pairs of light. This also depends very intimately, in order for this to work, on the polarization of the photons. And so you can't just send light of any kind of polarization and expect this to happen. You really have to get the atoms to start oscillating in a particular direction, so you need a particular polarization. And one thing we can do is if we send in horizontal light here, so the pump is that, we can make it so that these two guys come out vertically polarized. And that satisfies, there's a technical term for this, it's called phase matching. But basically, you just need, for this to happen, ensures that these conditions are met, that the energy and momentum will be conserved. So we can use this. This turns out to be a very good single photon source, because what happens is you're always guaranteed, if this process happens, to get a pair of photons. So I could put a detector right here. Whenever this detector clicks, I know I have a photon in my experiment. So we use this a lot for single photon experiments. Now, what we can do is do this process again. What would happen if I took this pump photon, and instead I put it in a quantum state of being diagonally polarized, which is just equal to, you know, it both being H and V. So equal superposition of H and V. It turns out this crystal right here, if it's aligned, you know, this direction, it'll only accept horizontally polarized photons, and only horizontally polarized photons will be producing V. I could create a second crystal that instead was aligned in the opposite direction. I could just take the crystal and rotate it. And in this case, I would need vertically polarized pump photons, and then it would produce red photons that are each H, the opposite polarization. So what happens if I take two of these crystals and I stack them one after the other, very thin, and I focus the light into it? Well, the horizontal component can either choose to create a pair here, so one will be oriented this way and this way. So I can have two possibilities, right? Either the horizontal photon will turn into a pair of vertical photons, or the vertical component in the second crystal will turn into a pair of horizontal photons. And if I focus the light so it's right in the middle, and these crystals are relatively small, I have no idea which crystal this has happened in. So I can take my pump photon, so the state of my system, it starts out as my pump photon being in the state H plus V. This is the pump. But now when I go through this process, well, the H, it could potentially, if we have H here, what could happen is H can get turned into V, V, two daughter photons, that's one process. Or the vertically polarized pump can then turn into two H's. And we have a Bell state. So that's how we can create our two photons, and they come out, and now they're going to be in say, this case, a 5-plus state. So that's one of our Bell states, and you can send those off to Alice and Bob. And that's how we do this in the lab. It turns out there's also other techniques. You can play other tricks with how you create these entangled photons. How good does this work? Well, it works much better than it used to, but it turns out this quantum process is a very rare event. It only works about one in about a billion times. So I have to send in a billion blue photons to get one pair of red photons out. Now, if you have really special high-tech crystals set up for special configurations, you can even get it down to about one in a million. But for the most part, it's about one in a billion. Luckily, photons are cheap, right? They're all around us. We can generate very powerful lasers. A powerful laser can have on the order of like 10 to the 20 photons per second or more in that you can hit it with. So it turns out you take your factor of 9, you can get easily millions and millions of photons out this way per second of pairs. And then you can use this to do one of these Bell violations where, you know, what I do is I take this pair of photons, I send one to Alice who has a polarizer that she can rotate. Bob can do his polarizer that he can rotate, and then you can look at the measurement outcomes and you created a bell. Okay, thank you very much.